So Shendan, we are discussing a very, very important topic called postpartum hemorrhage. And unlike obstructed and prolonged labor, postpartum hemorrhage, whether you are a nurse or a midwife, you should have adequate information about this condition so that you can meet a woman in a taxi who has delivered and is bleeding. You can find a woman anywhere, and you should be able to manage a woman with postpartum hemorrhage, though you may not be a midwife. Postpartum hemorrhage is among the top 5 causes of maternal mortality in Ghana. And most of the time, it's a leading cause of maternal mortality. This section explains the physiology of control of bleeding during the third stage of labor. The types of postpartum hemorrhage, their causes will also be explored. And then, most importantly, we should be able to manage any woman with postpartum hemorrhage, including resuscitation and further management. By the end of this session, we should be able to explain the normal mechanism of control of bleeding. If you want to understand postpartum hemorrhage, you should draw it from the physiology of control of bleeding after delivery so that you appreciate what went on wrong, and then you also appreciate why we are carrying out the different type of interventions. We'll be able to identify and diagnose primary and secondary postpartum hemorrhage. We'll say the aims of management of the postpartum hemorrhage and describe the initial and subsequent management of postpartum hemorrhage. This is the major reading, and then there are other ones in the reference list. When do we say a woman is having postpartum hemorrhage? What is a normal bleeding? How do we quantify bleeding in the postpartum period? Postpartum hemorrhage has been defined as excessive bleeding from the genital tract following the birth of a baby up to 6 weeks after delivery. We know that puerperium is right from delivery to 6 weeks after delivery. So when we are describing postpartum hemorrhage, we are not only talking of the bleeding occurring after delivery, we are talking about any bleeding from the genital tract during the first 6 weeks after the delivery. So any time that it occurs, it is still considered a postpartum bleeding. It's a blood loss of 500 milliliters or more, irrespective of the maternal condition, or any amount of blood loss, however small, that is likely to compromise the patient's hemodynamics. Now, we are saying that for a normal delivery, a blood loss of 100 to 150 mils should be normal. Now, if the woman is bleeding 500 mils or more, then we are saying that this woman is having a postpartum hemorrhage. Now, different writers have discussed this definition by WHO. And they are saying that if a woman enters into labor and she is already anemic, when she even bleeds 200 mils, it is clinically significant. So they are saying that we should diagnose postpartum hemorrhage irrespective of the quantity of blood loss. Once it affects the woman's hemodynamics or the woman's health, it should be diagnosed as postpartum hemorrhage, irrespective of the amount of blood loss. So if he had 300 mils of blood loss, 200 mils of blood loss, once it exceeds 100 to 150, and it is having effect on the woman's hemodynamics, the woman is going into shock. You don't say that because the blood loss is just 300, she is not having postpartum hemorrhage. Because of the effect on the woman, it is still postpartum hemorrhage, and it deserves all the attention that should be given to any postpartum hemorrhage. Now, blood loss at the end of labor is extremely difficult to measure. Remember that we could have some, by the time she comes, she is bleeding, some clothes is wet, sanitary pad has been changed twice, and it could be blood. How do you really quantify this amount of blood loss? So the amount of blood loss that we measure at the time of delivery using the clots, even that we are putting these clots in a jug, it is not fluid. If you are measuring clots of 400 mils. Now, if we should put in a citric acid and really convert this clot into fluid, are we going to get 400 mils or is it going to become more than 400 mils? But realize that the labor, well, the time that we measure the blood, most of the time clotted blood, and we use a graduated jug, and then we say we are measuring the amount lost. But it is not very accurate because they are clots. And then some have swelled, some have gone into pads, some have gone into clots. So it's very difficult to estimate amount of blood loss. So for instance, if you have 360 mils of clots, It is just telling you the solid part of the clot. The fluid part has been oozed out and absorbed into the needle you use for the delivery. So if you are writing 360 mils of blood, including cells and the volume, or just the cells, and if it is just the cells, then you can imagine how much fluid has been lost out of the cells. So it becomes very difficult to estimate blood loss during delivery. About 11% of all live deliveries are complicated with postpartum hemorrhage. And for now, it is topping the list of mortalities in Ghana. Remember that apart from the fact that it is topping the list for maternal mortality, postpartum hemorrhage also brings about a whole lot of morbidities. The woman may not die, but it can lead to a lot of damage. When we get to the complications, you appreciate what can happen to a woman. Even if we save the woman's life after postpartum hemorrhage, you can imagine the effects. Now, there are two main types of postpartum hemorrhage. We have the primary and then the secondary. Primary saying that it's occurring immediately after delivery, and secondary saying that it's occurring sometime later. So if within first 24 hours that the woman delivered, she is bleeding, then we say she's having primary postpartum hemorrhage. Once we have defined postpartum hemorrhage to extend to 6 weeks, if bleeding occurs any time after the 24th week, then it becomes, then it becomes secondary postpartum hemorrhage. But for the primary, it should be limited within the first 24 hours of delivery. It occurs during the third stage of labor, usually due to hypotonic uterine action. Or sometimes in the course of delivery, trauma can occur. There can be laceration of the cervix or the uterus, and that can lead to some bleeding immediately after delivery. So that is primary postpartum hemorrhage. In secondary postpartum hemorrhage, it is occurring sometime after 24 hours of delivery. And like I said earlier, it's still within the first 6 weeks after delivery. So if the woman bleeds, she is discharged home and she bleeds, and after 24 hours, any time, it is still postpartum hemorrhage. Remember that currently we are recording postpartum hemorrhages occurring after 72 hours or after 48 hours, where the woman is discharged home. So now the postpartum death is not occurring just after delivery, but 48 to 72 hours. And that must be taken notice of, so that when they come for their first postnatal visit within 72 hours, we know that we also have to rule out postpartum hemorrhage. This is uncommon as compared to the primary. It complicates 1 to 3% of all deliveries. And it normally occurs within the 8th day to the 14th day after delivery. And the majority of bleeding cases is not severe enough to threaten the patient's life, although occasionally it may require some immediate intervention. We want to look at the cause of primary postpartum hemorrhage. There are so many causes of postpartum hemorrhage. We want to group them under uterine atony, trauma, or coagulopathies. So all the facts, uterine atony is talking about loss of tone of the uterine muscles. We have said in the previous session that anytime the uterus loses its tone, then it can contract to stop bleeding after delivery. So bleeding will occur. If there is physical trauma to the tract, bleeding will occur. If you have a condition we call coagulopathies, where the clotting factors are not effective, then the woman can also continue bleeding after delivery. Now, some have tried to categorize the type, the causes of bleeding using what we call the four T's. In the four T's, they're talking about the tone of the uterus, they're talking about the tissue, whether we have some clot retained or the placenta retained. Then they also talk about throbbing, trauma, lacerations, inversion. Then the thrombin they refer to as coagulopathy. So thrombin is referring to clotting factors. So if clotting factors are defective, as we have in coagulopathy, so they have categorized the bleeding according to these four main T's. It makes it easier to memorize. But if you look at them, all the causes, they are the same as we have in the other classifications that we did. Remember that in the other classification, where we talk about uterine atony, those who do that classification put the tissues or retained clots also under uterine atony. Because in essence, the retained clots will only cause uterine atony. So we look at the causes according to the type. What are the factors under the major causes? So for uterine atony, it is failure of the uterine muscles to contract effectively so that the placental sites, the blood vessels that are exposed will be compressed. And then what we refer to as the living ligatures will perform their actions and engulf around the exposed blood vessels and stop it. So about 90% of cases of postpartum hemorrhage are due to uterine atony. So uterine atony is the major cause. But what causes uterine atony? There are so many factors that causes uterine atony. Incomplete separation of the placenta, retained product of conception in precipitated labor where the labor occurred within a very short time that the uterus couldn't take time to activate its living ligature action. The blood vessels will be exposed and bleeding will occur. In prolonged labor, we can have uterine atomy, we said it, in overdistension or any condition that causes overdistension of the uterus, like we have in polyhydramnios, or we have in multiple twin pregnancies or multiple pregnancies, sometimes a singleton baby, but very big, causing overdistension of the uterus, you can lead to uterine atony. And then when we have placenta previa, we can also have uterine atony. When we're doing placenta previa, we said that the placenta embeds in the lower uterine segment. And in the lower uterine segment, there are no living ligature actions. So once the placenta detaches, the blood vessels will continue to bleed. Placenta accreta is a situation where the placenta is adhered to the myometrium. It burrows deep into the maternal myometrium, and then it's difficult for you to separate the accreta. So the placenta is there, blood vessels are exposed, and bleeding occurs. When the woman goes through general anesthesia and they use halothane with or cyclopropane, then this woman can bleed. Now, in general anesthesia, the body is so much relaxed that the blood vessels are so relaxed. So when the baby is removed and the placenta is removed, the placental bed is so removed, so relaxed, the blood vessels are so relaxed and they just give out their contents. That's what makes uterine atony. And then oxytocin-stimulated labor, such as an induction or augmentation of labor. We can have hypertonic uterine action and then uterine atony may result. In case of multiparity, the woman has delivered several times, the uterus has become lax, like a balloon that has been blown on and off for a very long time. It has lost of muscle tone, so the woman can bleed. Then when we use tocolytic drug, that is drug that will suppress uterine action, sometimes the woman enters into preterm labor, and you want to give some drugs that will relax the uterine action so that we can prolong the pregnancy for a while. Now, if the woman goes on these tocolytic drugs and the uterus is relaxed, then we can have loss of muscle tone of the uterus. So she gets into labor and then she begins to bleed. If you use a drug that controls seizures, like magnesium sulfate that we use in preeclampsia and eclampsia, they will cause over-relaxation of the uterus and they can cause bleeding. Now, in conditions that we refer to as chorioamnionitis, we could also have distension of the uterus and we will lose the muscle tone of the uterus. Now, when you come to trauma being a major cause of postpartum hemorrhage, there are factors under the trauma. We can have cervical lacerations, we can have any tear in the genital tract, we can have either the vagina, sometimes we can have a clitoral tear where there is a tear across the clitoris up, and then we can also have very major perineal tears. First degree, second degree, third degree tears, they can all lead to prolonged bleeding. Other traumatic causes are rupture of the uterus, where there was excessive contractions and the uterus ruptured. Now the uterus has ruptured, placenta will detach, and there is bleeding in the uterus and around the uterus. And this tends, the trauma will cause bleeding. We also can have bleeding from episiotomy wounds. When the episiotomy wounds were so wide, blood vessels were exposed, then the woman can have postpartum bleeding. But remember that these ones are not very serious. Ruptured uterus can lead to shock and kill the woman, but bleeding from the episiotomy is not enough to cause shock to kill the woman. And there is something we call uterine inversion, where the fundus of the uterus comes out. Instead of, it comes out and then it protrudes. And it is very common when you do what you call fundal pressure, when the woman's labor is prolonged and you try to push the top part of the uterus as if to push down the baby, then the fundus, which is the upper part of the uterus, will be inverted and come out, and that can also lead to severe bleeding. If you have operative vaginal deliveries like forceps delivery, the forceps can cause severe tears to the cervix and the vaginal walls, and this can also cause bleeding or trauma. Macrosomia, when we have very large babies and we have shoulder dystocia and the baby cannot come out, it can give lacerations to the genital tract. Now let's talk about coagulopathies. In coagulopathies, we have said that for some reason the clotting factors are used up and the blood that is coming cannot clot. And if it cannot clot, then we have continuous bleeding. So it's a defect in the clotting mechanism and of the person, so the client tends to bleed freely. For the causes, it can be due to amniotic fluid embolism, especially if you have prolonged labor, placental side, so placenta is separating, some part is separated, some are still retained. Now the blood vessels are exposed, so once you contract and react and retract, the amniotic fluid can go through the blood vessels and enter into circulation. And when they enter into circulation, they are seen as a foreign body, and the body tries to arrest it. So all the bleeding factors come out to try to arrest the amniotic fluid that they have found in the bloodstream. And in the end, they are used up, and then the woman begins to bleed. When you have intrauterine death, when the uterus begins to stay there, after a while, some toxins are released, and then some bleeding occurs. Some coagulopathy results and bleeding occurs. In antepartum hemorrhage, especially abruptio placenta, remember when we're talking about abruptio placenta, we talk about revealed, concealed, and mixed. Now, in the concealed type, when the bleeding is within, or in the mixed type, when the bleeding is also being internal, then the clotting factors will come around it, trying to mop up the bleeding. And because the bleeding is also ongoing, the clotting factors will also be used up. And then when this occurs, then the coagulopathies will occur and bleeding will continue. In cases of very severe preeclampsia, you can also have coagulopathies occurring. So, for instance, in postpartum, you can have the condition referred to as DIC. In DIC, we are talking about disseminated intravascular coagulopathy. When we get there, we will explain how DIC occurs, how the clotting factors are used up, and how this woman pours as if a tap has been opened and the woman goes into shock. Now, other factors, causes of primary postpartum hemorrhage, these are not very strong factors, but they have been found to be associated with primary postpartum hemorrhage. We can have mismanagement of the third stage of labor, where there was failure to give oxytocin drug at the right time. In our active management, once baby comes out and we rule out retain of placenta, we rule out retain of a twin, then we give an oxytocin drug. What it is doing is that it is helping the uterus to contract. So by the time placenta has come out, contraction has also occurred, and then there will be no bleeding. So if you mismanage the third stage and you don't give the oxytocin drug, then placenta comes out and bleeding follows. There is another mismanagement we call fundus fiddling, where we manipulate the uterus trying to cause some contractions. And thus we say that it precipitates arrhythmic or incoordinate uterine contraction, and this can cause partial separation of the placenta. And that, when that happens, then you can have some loss of blood. A full bladder, we say that the bladder has an anatomical relationship with an anterior anatomical relationship with the uterus. So if the bladder is full, it sits on the uterus and the uterus is not able to contract effectively. So now baby is out, placenta is out, uterus must contract, and then uterus is still relaxed because bladder sits on it and prevents effective contraction. And then application of excessive traction on the unseparated placenta to hasten the third stage. So if you are pulling the placenta and realize it is still at head, it could even be an acquitter. So you don't continue pulling, you call for intervention, and then you manage it. Predisposing factors to postpartum hemorrhage. Past obstetric history. If the woman had a previous postpartum hemorrhage, she is likely going to have another postpartum hemorrhage, depending on the cause. If the woman has a high parity, she had uterine scar tissue with successive pregnancies, and thus reduces the contractility of the uterine muscle fibers. If the woman had fibroid uterus, then the fibroid will not lead to effective contraction of the uterus, even after the third stage, so bleeding is likely. If she had maternal anemia, when we were discussing anemia, you remember we said that one of the complications is postpartum hemorrhage, because it is like the consistency or the viscosity of the blood has been affected. It has become more fluid, and it can pour more readily as compared to a very viscous blood. So if the anemia of below 10 grams, it's what we started with at the time of labor, then when we pour a little bit, we are going to be predisposed to postpartum hemorrhage. Instrumental delivery, especially forceps, we've spoken about that. Antepartum hemorrhage, any person who had an antepartum hemorrhage is also prone to postpartum hemorrhage, especially if the antepartum hemorrhage was due to something like a placenta previa. Then when she delivers, there will be bleeding. In immunosuppressive conditions such as HIV and AIDS, they have lower platelet count to such a degree that any little bleeding, they cannot really arrest the hemorrhage. It is believed that 2/3 of all women who come in with postpartum hemorrhage, if you look back on their antenatal card, they had an identifiable risk factor. Now, the clinical manifestations, it depends on whether it is atony, whether it is trauma, whether it is coagulopathy. So if the woman is bleeding, what will help you to be able to differentiate and say that this bleeding is likely coming from the source? Because it could be due to any of these factors you find on the screen. So if it is an atonic uterus, these are the signs that you look for. The uterus will be soft, the uterus will be big, the uterus will be boggy. Sometimes it may feel like a dough. Enlargement as a result of accumulation of blood or blood clots will occur. So when the woman delivers and she is bleeding, and the uterus is very soft, because after delivery, the uterus should be very tight. It should tighten up like a tennis ball. So if for any reason it is soft, and then it is still not under the symphysis pubis, but over, you can really palpate and realize that it is boggy, it feels like a dough, it is big in size, then you know that this woman is bleeding, but the cause may be due to atonic uterus. If you want to find out if it's due to a trauma, the uterus will be well contracted. So if uterus is well contracted, it means there is nothing inside, so it is not atony of the uterus. So anytime you find a well contracted uterus, you have ruled out uterine atony. So now she is bleeding, and it comes out steadily. So the flow is very consistent and steadily. Uterus is well contracted. Then you know that a blood vessel may be torn, either in the cervix or either in the vagina or in the uterus. So that's as a result of trauma. If it's coagulopathy, the blood also pours out freely like in trauma. But in coagulopathy, you may not find any clots. In the trauma, it comes out and it is clotting. In coagulopathy, the blood is just pouring out freely. It does not clot. So it tells you that it's a clotting defect. So just by looking at the nature of the bleeding, you'll be able to tell where it is coming from, and then you'll be able to aim at the place or the cause immediately. Now, apart from these main ones that we talk about, for the general signs, it's just like the signs for anybody who is bleeding excessively. We have tachycardia, low blood pressure, altered level of consciousness, restlessness and drowsiness. We can have maternal collapse, and then we can also have pallor. In our management, because we have said they are coming from different sources, the most important thing in our management is identification of where it is the blood is coming from. But before she even enters into labor, we can also do screening and referral of women who are at high risk. So if you go to the desk, realize that if a woman comes in, she wants to deliver, you say, your HB is less than 10, go to the big hospital. And sometimes we don't tell them exactly why we are saying that. Once your HB is low, you are prone to postpartum hemorrhage, and you should deliver in a facility where you can have access to emergency obstetric and neonatal care. So any woman who had a previous PPH, previous APH, we said, because they are prone, we screen and detect them, and then we plan a care for them. You have to do active management of the third stage. pre and post delivery HB check, we have said that. And then fixing baby to birth immediately following delivery also aids with contraction of the uterus. So these are general things that we can do to prevent postpartum hemorrhage. We can do careful management. Remember, we have said that the bladder should always be emptied. We should do proper recording of the onset of labor, monitor the process closely, avoid dehydration, exhaustion. An obstetrician should be called if there are any signs of prolonged labor. Don't say that, I want to help the woman. CS is expensive, so you continue trying. Call an intervention before she develops PPH and you may not be able to handle. A syntocinone infusion may be required, and this should be maintained for at least 1 hour after the end of the third stage of labor. Active management of third stage should be done. We said that education of the woman is also important when we want to prevent the condition. Now, if the condition happens, there are basic principles of our care. We want to arrest the bleed that is occurring. We want to resuscitate the mother. We want to replace the fluid that is lost, and we want to deliver the placenta. Management depends on whether you are at a district level or at the hospital. You call the doctor, you ensure strict bed rest, and then is the placenta out, is the placenta in? Remember that all our management of postpartum hemorrhage is important, because once the placenta remains inside, there is uterine atony. Whatever you do, still the woman will continue bleeding. So is placenta out, is placenta in? They form the basis of our management. You take the blood for grouping and cross-matching, you monitor the vital signs and close monitoring of intake and output. It's important that we give oxygen to this woman. We may transfuse if necessary. We assess the amount of blood loss and then light fundal pressure to expel the clots in the uterus. We may give an oxytocin to sustain the contractions so that the vessels will be occluded and the bleeding will stop. If the bleeding persists with low BP, with low blood pressure, you give ergots, you put the baby to breast. You empty the urinary bladder. You examine the woman for the source of bleeding. So for instance, you go into the vagina, you part the vagina, you want to check if it's coming from the vaginal walls. You may use a speculum to inspect the cervix and see if there's any cervical tear. Now, if it is any other tear like the uterus, on palpation, you may find the shape and even the size of the uterus. And it will help you to know how to manage the person. You assist the woman in carrying out all the self-care activities. So that is the general care you give to the woman. You empty the bladder, rub up uterine contractions, you do bimanual uterine compression and the aseptic technique. So your one hand goes in there, another hand is on the abdomen, and you are trying to press on the uterus at the fundus to stop the bleeding. Also what we call compression of abdominal aorta. You palpate the femoral pulse with the other hand to check for adequacy of compression. If the pulse rate is palpable, it is inadequate. But if pulse is not palpable, then it means that you have done a good compression of the abdominal aorta. And you maintain compression until bleeding is controlled. And sometimes you can do what you call a condom tamponade. We insert an ordinary condom and then we put a Foley's catheter in the condom, and then we inflate the balloon end, we inflate the end of the condom and it forms a balloon, or if it is normal saline, it becomes a ball, so that this ball will compress the exposed blood vessels and then try to stop the bleeding. Cytotec is also given, or misoprostol is given per rectum to stop bleeding, and then you examine the membranes of the placenta for completeness. Is the membranes complete? Are the membranes intact? Are they completely out? You examine them. Is there any hole in the placenta telling you that a lobe in this placenta has been retained? Is there any link from the placenta telling you that it was an extra lobe or extracentuate placenta and that the lobe has been retained in the uterus? So you examine the placenta completely for any lobes or any extra placenta which has been retained. Now you do evacuation of the uterus if there are retained products. For instance, the placenta was out, but clots and then the membranes are retained. So you do evacuation of the uterus and then you bring out this content. If the placenta is still in the uterus, then you will give, you empty the bladder. You don't give anything by mouth, because if it is an aqueous, we may have to end up in the theater. So once you realize that P placenta is undelivered, you wrap up a contraction to see if it will come out. You empty the bladder, but you don't give the patient any food. You attempt a control cord traction where you hold on to the cord and try to pull it out. So you pull it upwards, downwards, and then outwards. And then you administer, you give adequate resuscitation by administering oxygen by face mask. Placenta is still in, so you try and see if you can deliver the placenta. Now after delivering the placenta, you empty the bladder, you wrap up another contraction, you continue giving an oxytocin drug. And then you give a firm massage or wrap on the uterus so that you're able to stimulate contraction and expel the clot in the uterus. You also give IV injections of EGOT, and because you want to maintain some level of contraction for some time, you pass a catheter. Then the placenta and membranes are examined again, and if the placenta is incomplete, exploration is done. Surgical management: if there is difficulty removing the placenta, we do what you call manual removal of the placenta, where we go inside the uterus to bring it. If it's a morbidly adhered placenta, then there may be the need for you to open up and remove it. Sometimes when the bleeding is too severe, we do hypogastric artery ligation, because the hypogastric artery will supply the uterus. So we cut the hypogastric artery so that no blood is sent to the uterus. And in very severe cases, and we consider other factors like my woman has enough children, she doesn't need any more children, then we go to do hysterectomy, where we remove totally the uterus. So now this treatment is when placenta is out. The one we discussed was placenta in. If placenta is out, then is uterus well contracted? If uterus is not well contracted, then you follow as we did for retained products. Now, if uterus is well contracted, then you follow as it's not well contracted. If uterus is not well contracted, you follow as you did for retained products. And you also want to rule out a succinctuate placenta or an extra lobe of the placenta being inside. You carry out a speculum inspection for visualization and repair under general anesthesia if it is due to trauma. An episiotomy wound or tear of the anterior labia. So if it is due to trauma, the uterus will be well contracted. So you know that it is not coming from retained products. So the first thing you do is to do inspection or visualization. You also look for the episiotomy, whether it is well sutured, any torn blood vessel found. And then you clamp and you do what you call ligation. And then if it's episiotomy tears, then it means that you may have to re-suture the tear. Then transfusion. In terms of coagulopathies, here it is the clotting factor that are defective. So we don't need suturing, we don't need any rubbing of the uterus, because the uterus is well contracted. So what we need is replacement of the clotting factors. So you do immediate transfusion of fresh blood, and then we want the platelets and the factor 5 and 8 replaced immediately. If the bleeding persists, then hysterectomy must be done. Hypogastric artery ligation can also help with the DIC, with coagulopathies. So that was for primary postpartum hemorrhage. Now we look at secondary postpartum hemorrhage. In secondary postpartum hemorrhage, we have said that it is bleeding and it is occurring after 24 weeks of gestation, after 24 hours of delivery. So what can cause bleeding after the first day of delivery? It can be what we call subinvolution. It can be an infection. It can be a retained product. Maybe some membranes or clots were retained during the third stage. So it will be there after 24 hours. When the uterus is not contracting well, then the bleeding will start. It can be due to uterine polyps that is bleeding, because it might have suffered some compression during the time of delivery. We can also have what we call the submucous fibroids or choriocarcinoma. So the lochia is heavier than normal, it's offensive, and then especially if there is any infection. And then you can also have tachycardia. The woman will have pyrexia. It tells you that there is an infection occurring during the preperium. Now other signs of infection may also be present, and there may be cramping or abdominal pain. The blood loss will be heavy, and the patient may be pale and eventually develop signs of shock. On vaginal examination, you may see a blood clot either in the vagina or retained placental tissue may be pulsing out through the cervical canal. If you want to prevent postpartum hemorrhage, then the treatment of anemia is important before she even enters into labor. Active management of third stage is important. Give good nutrition to this woman before, during pregnancy, even before labor starts, so that she builds her iron stores and improves the HB. She should only be delivered by a skilled birth attendant. So either a midwife or an obstetrician. And then you call a doctor immediately you realize there is any problem. Make sure that after delivery you express every clot from the uterus. You give a light fundal pressure and the clots will come out. You encourage mother to empty the bladder throughout the labor. And also you give oxytocin drugs to aid contractions. So on the management, you set up an IV line. If it happens, you keep all sanitary pads because we want to be able to have a rough estimate of how much bleeding has occurred. If the bleeding persists, you prepare for theater for possible evacuation of the uterus. And depending on what happens, other things may continue. You give a broad spectrum antibiotic, you continue with the oxytocin drug. When you go and do evacuation, you take a sample for histology. So you do some curettage and then you take the sample. You send the biopsy. Complications of postpartum bleeding. Sheehan syndrome. Sheehan syndrome is a very serious condition. It affects the mother right from the hair to every organ in her body. The initial stages, failure of lactation, she will not be able to breastfeed. And then amenorrhea in mild cases. Later on, this woman will have some adrenal involvement, thyroid involvement, some pancreatic and ovarian insufficiency in severe cases. Now, if you talk about Sheehan syndrome, it means pituitary necrosis. There is, when the woman was bleeding profusely, the blood supply to the brain was cut, and the blood supply to the pituitary was also diminished. So there is ischemia to the pituitary gland, and there is some necrosis. So this pituitary gland is a master gland that controls all other glands. So if pituitary gland is affected, then you can understand why the adrenal is coming in, the thyroid is coming in, and some other glands will also be affected. There will be atrophy of the breast and loss of hair. You can have acute renal failure. Peripheral sepsis is likely to occur, and then you can have very severe anemia. These are the references, and that is the end of our postpartum hemorrhage.